There's probably no better way to briefly explain what all of this means, all of the theory that we've looked at in the previous videos, what that means for psychoanalysis, and what it means for transference in particular, than to summarise what Laplanche writes in his book, New Foundations for Psychoanalysis. Now, in his account of the fundamental anthropological situation, Laplanche has described how the encounter with the adult other is, in a sense, inaugural for the child. It sets in motion the processes of translation and its obverse repression. It establishes the division between the ego and the unconscious. And from this initial encounter with the other, sprouts the first shoots of infant sexuality. We can say that before this encounter with the other, before the other's message has been implanted into the psychic skin of the infant does not exist, not in a subjective sense. And the psychoanalytic situation reactivates this primal encounter. And those who criticise psychoanalysis for infantilising the patient, in a sense, are quite right. It does infantilise the patient, but it does so with good reason. The analyst offers herself to the subject, to the patient, as someone who is supposed to know. This is Lacan's crucial concept. Someone who is supposed to know, but who at the same time refuses knowledge. And this offer creates what Laplanche calls a hollow, or a space. And into this space, the patient can place either another hollow or something full. If he places something full into this hollow, we see laid out before us a cast of characters. We see his mother, his father, himself as a child, the relationships between all of them. All of these imagos will be unpacked and loaded into the hollow that's been created by the analyst. And the analyst will interpret them. She'll say, "You're protesting as if I were your mother," for example. But if this is all we have, psychoanalysis kind of reaches a dead end. Whereas if the patient places into this hollow that the analyst has offered up, if the patient places another hollow in there, this is where we see the enigmas, the emptinesses, the mysteries of childhood, which are reactivated in the analysis. And the fact that the enigmatic situation itself is recreated, these ubiquitous questions of the patient that we have all had and all heard. What does she want from me? What does the analyst want from me? And what does she know? All of this means that these mysteries can be investigated and worked through via the analysis. And we might see the positive imagos, in other words, the positive transference in which one treats the analyst as if he were a mother or a father. We might see these as the attempt at solving the enigma posed within the hollow transference. So how does the analyst work with these full and hollow transferences? Laplanche emphasises the need for the analyst to be on the lookout for ambiguities and ambivalences within these full transferences. He says, "Full and hollow transference are two different but complementary aspects of the same thing, but it's only when a split appears in the heart of the transferential imagos or scenes, only when it is possible to slip in the knife, that full transference can evolve into hollow transference and be worked through." So we can see from the fact that the original seduction is a fundamental anthropological situation, in other words, that every human subject passes through this situation, irrespective of our diagnostic structure, albeit we all do it differently with different accents, different levels of force. But the fact that every human being passes through this fundamental situation means that transference is not a neurosis per se. It can't be a neurosis. It can't be something pathological which can be resolved. And Laplanche suggests that dissolving the transference would be akin to soaring through the branch that one is sitting on. Transference is, he says, a relationship with the enigmatic object. And it's the analyst's job to provoke it, not to dissolve it, but to dissolve full transference into hollow transference. And in one of his last papers, one of the last papers he ever wrote, Freud considered the question of whether an analysis is terminable or interminable. But given that transference cannot be resolved or dissolved, we'd have to conclude that analysis is interminable, or at least the human capacity for translation is interminable. But this doesn't mean that an analysis never ends. Of course it ends, it surely must end. The question is when. So, I'm not sure how helpful this is, but as we started these videos with an astronomical reference, the reference to Ptolemy and Copernicus, we'll end with one as well. We'll end with one more final astronomical reference. And we'll do this by quoting Laplanche. He says, "In astronautics, the precise lapse of time when the launching of a spaceship is possible is called a window. It would be a question either of going into orbit from the Earth, or the departure from a satellite already in orbit of a vessel aiming to leave the Earth's gravitational system. Likewise, for departures from analysis, there are favourable windows which it can be judged opportune to take advantage of, or failing which, gravitation reasserts its pull for another turn of the spiral."